So the next speaker is Dr. Vardhaman Kankria. He'll be talking about decision making in LASIK reject patients.
Hello. Yes. So at the onset, I would like to thank Dr. Darak sir for this opportunity to speak in his symposium. And also I would like to thank Dr. Saravati sir to let me go before my scheduled time because I have an IC in Hall B after this. So can I have my slides, please? So I think till the time the slides come up, I would like to ask probably Dr. Saravati and Dr. Darak if, like, what are the number of eyes or patients that you have to actually reject for LASIK today? Like, out of 100 people, how many are LASIK rejects?
It's almost 20% of the patients.
20%. What about you?
Yeah, sir? I would also reject these cases. I mean, maybe 10 to 20% is definitely so.
Right.
Yeah.
So the point that we are trying to bring out is that there are a lot of people who are still not, they are not suitable for LASIK. So don't consider that you have learned only LASIK procedures, so you become a refractive surgeon. You have to also understand the other procedures and the nuances of it and also understand when to use what. So before we start on the LASIK rejects, we have to understand that LASIK today is probably the most popular refractive surgery world over. It was in 1990 when the first LASIK was performed. And LASIK actually did demonstrate various advantages over the PRK in those times, like efficacy of treating high refractive errors with high predictability, fast visual recovery with a very great satisfaction rate. And this is what made LASIK extremely popular. So if you see today, the patients, they think about refractive surgery, they think about LASIK. That is what they will come asking you. But what we have to also understand is that your decision has to be completely customized depending on variety of factors, and one size does not fit all. So all the patients are not suitable to undergo LASIK procedures. So that's why we have a huge armamentarium of the procedures available today. I'm not going into the details of everything, but just going to give you a small idea as general ophthalmologist what we are speaking here about. So who are the LASIK rejects? The LASIK rejects can be an underage patient who is less than 18 years of age or even more than 55 years, because probably would like to go for lens-based procedures that time. A patient who has collagen vascular diseases, has any active ocular disease happening right now, has unstable refractive error, is currently pregnant or is including breastfeeding, they become directly a complete rejects for not only LASIK but also all kinds of refractive procedures. But when we talk about the other factors such as the occupation, patients who are wrestlers, football players, rugby players who are in contact sports can have injury to the eye. We don't want a flap. If the cornea is on thinner side, we don't have the enough residual bed thickness. And if a very high refractive error is to be corrected, then there are issues associated with LASIK procedure itself. And of course, the most important thing is topographic abnormalities. So here is the first case in which it's a 23-year-old boxer, has a relatively moderate to high myopia of 7.5 diopters, has normal tomography, excellent corneal thickness. So basically, as we understand, they are always at high risk of ocular trauma and flap displacement. So this is a reason that he will become a LASIK reject. So in this particular patient, of course, you can go for two kinds of flap-less procedures. One is doing a surface ablation, which is a wonderful procedure as well. But for such high myopes, my procedure to go to in this patient is relaxed smile procedure, which is essentially a flap-less LASIK procedure. So as you can see in this case, what exactly is relaxed smile is with the help of a femtosecond laser, we are creating a lenticule intrastromally. And when this lenticule is created, we don't cut open the flap, but instead we make a small side cut. And from that side cut, the lenticule is removed. So whatever keratomelusis or change of corneal shape that you have to achieve is achieved without cutting the flap. So this gives you the advantage of LASIK without cutting the flap, and also gives you advantage over the surface ablation in terms of its comfort, the earlier visual recovery, as well as post-operative less pain as compared to the surface ablation, and less regression for high myopia as well. So of course, in this patients, as we have discussed, there is no flap to get displaced. LASIK, the smile compared to the LASIK is going to maintain much better corneal biomechanical strength. Again, this is something which is probably slightly not completely proven, but theoretically speaking, if we see the anterior stromal lamellae are supposed to demonstrate the highest amount of corneal stiffness or biomechanical strain to the inert cornea. So what happens in LASIK is that we are cutting the flap in the anterior lamellae and we are doing the laser. So we are getting rid of the most strongest part of the cornea. As against that, in SMILE, we are trying to leave behind the anterior lamellae. So supposedly increasing the or keeping back the biomechanical strength. So at the same time, we have to also understand that there we don't have enough tools right now. So in terms of the biomechanics also, probably there is no single tool which is very accurate to demonstrate this, but this is probably a theoretical advantage of SMILE. But at the same time, definitely the dry eye is much lesser in SMILE as compared to LASIK. So a patient who is LASIK reject because of moderate dry eye or mild dry eye, definitely a surface ablation or a SMILE becomes the procedure of choice, because the corneal sensations are also maintained much better. The corneal nerves are also, they are also maintained much better. There are various studies which have also shown that all dry eye parameters, including the objective and the subjective analysis, also show much better outcomes in SMILE as compared to LASIK for them. So when we come to the other scenario in which we have actually a thinner cornea, about 470 micron, 473 microns, and have a moderate myopia of minus 4 diopters, of course we don't want to cut a flap. In this case, surface ablation seems to the way to go. The surface ablation has advantage of being minimally invasive. It affects only the necessary stroma, as we are doing the ablation only on the anterior aspect. There are less chances of ectasia as compared to the LASIK procedure. Minimally induced aberrations, let's say if the epithelium heals very nicely, and a much faster dry eye recovery as compared to LASIK, because we are not cutting the flap. When it comes to the surface ablation, now the term that we use is called as advanced surface ablation, and this is a term which is going to explain the evolution from the previous generation PRK days. So what is done in the advanced surface ablation is either we are doing PRK along with the mitomycin C, or we are doing what is called as AP LASIK or LASIK. So AP LASIK and LASIK are different ways of removing the epithelium. So what are the advantages of the advanced surface ablation is that now there is a reduced postoperative pain and discomfort. There is a minimal corneal haze as compared to the PRK days without the mitomycin C in those times. Increased quality of vision, again because of lack of haze. And the epithelial removal is the thing that I think most of the people are working on. There are various ways in which you can remove epithelium. Either you can do mechanical epithelial removal by blade or by rotating brush. You can do epithelial removal with the help of alcohol, in which you are actually using a diluted alcohol to loosen the junctional complexes of the epithelium with the underlying underlying basement membrane, so that the epithelium can slide very easily. You can use an AP LASIK procedure, in which it uses a very blunt keratome. It is going to slide the epithelium in one corner, and epithelial removal can also be done today with excellent lasers with the transepithelial PRK. So this is one of the approaches that we do use. I use two kinds of brushes. One is Professor Palikaris's brush called as PAL brush. This is the one that we are looking at. As you can see, this is very high speed rotation, and you are actually getting rid of the epithelium very nicely. So there is another variation of the same brush which is also available today. It's called as Amoyle's brush. So after this epithelium is removed, you use eczema laser to ablate, use mitomycin C over it, and then put a contact lens in place. So if you want to remove epithelium by AP LASIK, so what is done? This is like a blunt microkeratome. As you can see, this is like a plastic keratome in which the epithelial sheet is slided off. And that is how the epithelial LASIK or AP Polish LASIK or AP LASIK is performed. What has really changed in surface ablation in terms of its ability to correct the errors, not only more long term but also reducing the haze as well, is the role of mitomycin C. We all understand mitomycin C has been very popular as systemic chemotherapeutic agent. It has seen to have long term cytostatic effect on the tissue. So this mitomycin C is used now with the PRK, AP LASIK as well as with LASIK. So depending on the amount of ablation that you're doing, the mitomycin C is used. In most cases, I use it for 12 seconds, but if I'm ablating more than minus 4 diopters, then I increase it to about 20 to 25 seconds. And for all the secondary corrections, like if I'm doing a PRK over a flap or over a SMILE, then I use it for a minute or so. So of all these different techniques of surface ablations, is there a difference of the outcomes? So we conducted a study in the University of Crete, which we published in JCRS in 2014, in which we did a contralateral study. Between one eye was done with PRK and mitomycin C, and the other eye underwent AP LASIK procedure. So what we have seen in both these techniques, they give similar visual, refractive, and corneal structural outcomes in patients with myopia which was mild to moderate up to 2 years postoperatively. This remains as one of the very few cases which are contralateral studies for these techniques. But it also brings down the important thing that whatever is the technique of surface ablation that you want to choose for this LASIK reject patients, you can choose any of them that you're most comfortable with. There are other reasons for selecting surface ablation over LASIK, apart from thin corneas, is that if you have a significant dry eye and if there is a basement membrane dystrophy. Anybody can tell me if there is a basement membrane dystrophy why LASIK is contraindicated? What happens if you do LASIK in people who have EBMD or epithelial basement membrane dystrophy? These people are at high risk of developing epithelial ingrowths into the interface. So that's why LASIK has to be avoided in them. This is a very straightforward reject case for LASIK. In this case, in fact, doing a surface ablation becomes treatment not only for the refractive error, but it also becomes a treatment for the EBMD as well. If you have any person who is in contact sports and army and has low myopia, definitely surface ablation is one of my go-to techniques. But what about patients who have very high errors, like minus 12? There has been days, I'm sure, that both Dr. Sarawat and Dr. Darak has been those early through these early days when people used to actually treat minus 14, minus 16, minus 17 diopters on LASIK as well. But today the norm is that you don't typically correct more than 9 or minus 10 diopters because whenever you are doing LASIK, there are certain untoward effects that you are causing for very high ablations. I'll come to that as well. So this is a patient in which the correction required is minus 12. And on the other side, of course, he has a very, very thin cornea, which is 440 microns. And the anterior chamber depth is excellent. It is 3.2. So if you have a high myopia more than minus 9, a hyperopia more than plus 5 diopters, astigmatism more than 4 diopters, definitely corneal laser procedures, including LASIK, is not it should not be attempted and should be rejected. So in this case, if the anterior chamber depth is very good, you can do phakic IOLs, or if the anterior chamber depth is less than 3 millimeters, then the only choice is refractive lens exchange. Doing LASIK in very high myopias can cause loss of best-corrected spectacular acuity, can cause high risk of regression, high risk of iatrogenic ectasia, also induction of very high higher order aberrations, so these patients have a lot of halos and glare. So that's why the LASIK should be rejected in these patients. As we know, the phakic IOLs are artificial lenses implanted in the anterior or the posterior chamber of the eye in presence of natural crystalline lens to correct refractive errors. They are typically indicated if the refractive error is, let's say, not in the LASIK zone or the corneal laser zone, but you have to have enough space in the ACD. You should have a minimal endothelial cell density of 2,500. cells and no, of course, active ocular pathology. And most importantly, the crystalline lens has to be completely clear. There is an important optical advantage of phakic lenses. Like many of my patients, for example, if I have done a phakic lens on one eye and happen to do even a smile on the other eye or even femtolasic on the other eye, they always prefer the eye for high metropia in which I have done the phakic IOLs. The reason being the amount of clarity and the level of the high definition that they can see with this is much better than with any corneal procedures. And it's also especially because it is very close to the nodal point, and this gives them an effective zone of 1.25 times more than the corneal laser procedures itself. And of course, there is no induction of aberrations for high corrections that we have in corneal lasers as well. So, of course, there is slight improvement in visual acuity in this patient. So a lot of people that are probably seeing 6-9 partial with minus 14 diopters of glasses, probably they tend to see even 6-6 partial unaided after the procedure is done. And of course, with the cornea untouched, you have a better quality of vision in that case. Of course, there are certain complications such as increase in intraocular pressure. You have to now, with the new designs of the lenses, that has really reduced a lot. If you take care, then usually the cataract is a very uncommon complication, but it can happen especially if your vault is very low. So you have to just take care of those things and make sure that your workup for this patient, especially the sizing of the ICL, is extremely important. So currently there are different materials used. The silicone was used for something called as PRL. The collamer is the most commonly used one, which is called as the current ICL, which is the implantable collamer lenses. And the hydrophilic acrylic material is used with some of the Indian counterparts, such as IPCL or refractive lens from the Appasamy, as well as from Biotech. So there are three Indian companies which also make it. They are decently good, I will say, definitely. Definitely the implantable collamer lenses are currently the standard of care. They are made up of porcine collagens, and they are currently the most biocompatible. They can treat up to minus 20 diopters of refractive errors. So this is a study which our group had published, in which one eye underwent phakic IOL, the other eye underwent LASIK, and for 10 years, or for 9 years, the follow-up was seen. And what was seen is that after 9 years, the eye which had undergone LASIK had regressed to about minus 2 diopters, and the eye which had undergone ICL was doing extremely good. So, and in certain situations such as this, in which the myopia is low, only minus 4 diopters, as you can see, the topography seems to be dicey. It is a keratoconus suspect. So you are not going to touch the cornea again. You will choose probably to do the phakic lenses. And in extreme ametropias, the bioptics are the way to go. If you have a very high refractive error in the tune of 26, 27, then you can combine the ICL also with the refractive surgeries. And coming to the last one, of course, if you have a frank case of keratoconus, then of course, I think none of the refractive surgeries should be attempted. The patient has to be observed for progression. And if the progression is seen, collagen cross-linkage has to be done. But after the collagen cross-linkage is done, depending on the topography, various refractive procedures can be combined in keratoconus as well. But in the view of time, I'm not going to come to that. So this is the last case I'm talking to you about. So for example, this is a patient who came with very low thickness of 460 microns, had a suspicious topography, and had about minus 6 diopters of myopia. So if you see, in this case, of course, we would not really attempt corneal laser procedure. We would have love to do a ICL procedure, but the ACD is only 2.7, which is 2.8 is our limit. So we cannot go less than 2.8. So because it is also 2.7, we cannot do the ICL. So the last option remains as lens exchange. But in this case, this patient had multiple atrophic holes, had very strong family history of retinal detachment. So what to do in this case when all the options are exhausted? You should decide to do no intervention. So there are going to be LASIK rejects in which no refractive surgery should also be attempted and told to the patient, although they can be very expectant and aggressive in demanding it. But you should know where to limit yourself. Okay. Thank